You might have heard about pemmican, the food that adds 1000 calories to meat, gives your dupes +4 morale, and never spoils. It's a great alternative for space travels if you don't need the massive morale boost that a superb, dehydrated food provides, and it's easy to mass produce in the early game. See, you might have seen some complicated spigot ranches in the past, where people had to use cooling loops and lights to grow bonbon trees as food source for spigots, or had to feed sulfur to sweetles to make sucrose and feed that. It was further complicated by the fact that spigots don't drown, and you had to wait for them to die on their own, or send in hitman. Well, with the recent update to the game and the gentle nudge by Maggie 210, I am happy to present you a solution that doesn't require putting the harmless pups to the sword. Behold, Emulsifier! With the emulsifier and plant pulverizer, which are easily accessible in the early game, you can make loads and loads of food from basically slime and meat, and you don't need any fancy cooking equipment. You'll start by digging out some slime. For the first batch, you'll need 300 kg of slime. You'll throw that into plant pulverizer, pipe the output liquid, fit the oil into the emulsifier, add 40 kg of bleach stone, and produce biodiesel. This will give you 200 kg of biodiesel, and what you have to do now is pipe it directly into some cold environment. This can be frozen biome, some cooled room like this one that I use for endless food preservation, or even liquid carbon dioxide from carbon dioxide geyser. Anything, as long as it's colder than minus 13 degrees Celsius. Yes, minus 13, not minus 10 as it says here, because the game adds a few degrees to all state change temperatures to simplify simulation and prevent endless back and forth. So once you've cooled the biodiesel, you will have 200 kg of tallow on your hands. That's enough to make 200 pemmicans or 520,000 calories. To put that in perspective, that's enough food to keep 5 duplicants fed for 100 cycles. The only thing you'll still need is meat, but that's not a big problem because you have plenty of critters roaming about the asteroid as you start the game, providing a steady supply of meat. As long as you snack just one meat per cycle, you're good to feed 2.6 dupes. For comparison, turning that same meat into barbecue only feeds 2 dupes. Having a simple pip or hatch wrench would solve your food problems for a long, long time. And then, if you get lucky and find some wild ingredients, like a plume blossom or nosh bean, you can start cranking out squash fries or nosh noms worth 5,400 and 5,000 calories, plus a nice +8 morale boost. Even better, if you've got sleet wheat or megafronts lying around, toss in some paku or seneschal meat and you'll get great meals with 4200 calories and a whopping +12 morale. Paku, in particular, are super easy to ranch, and each wild sleet wheat gives you 18 grains every 72 cycles. Every time I play this game, I always rely on wild sleet wheat and frost buns to keep my dupes fed, but that's only 1200 calories per 3 sleet wheat grains, so 400 calories per grain. And one paku can be turned into 1600 or 1800 calories, so 2 grains plus 1 paku equals 2600 calories at most, and you have to cook 2 meals, whereas fish taco gives you 4200 calories, bigger morale boost, and is cooked just once. If I were to start a new game today, I would definitely replace frost buns with fish tacos, and if my planetoid turned out to be devoid of sleet wheat, I'd know I can always rely on pemmican. Just keep in mind that pemmican is the only food made with tallow that doesn't spoil. All the others will, and they require a deep fryer to cook. Producing tallow is about the only early game use for emulsifier. In a pinch, you could burn biodiesel in a petroleum generator, but sadly, biodiesel doesn't work as rocket fuel. Its only other real use is making blast shots, which are used for breaking meteorites to bits during meteor showers, so you don't have to waste time mining them later. Or if you're playing on Relica Minor, the prehistoric planet, for destroying the Demolior, an impact or asteroid that you have a set amount of cycles to get rid of based on the difficulty you set at the start. Where you don't even have an oil biome to produce any petroleum, the second way to make these blast shots. Now, as concerns late game, ever since Emulsifier was introduced in the prehistoric pack update, it replaced Molecular Forge for some endgame materials, and apart from biodiesel is now used to produce Visco-Gel, supercoolant and salt water. Let's quickly go through the first two and talk about whether you even need them. We'll skip salt water because I don't know why you would even make any, except for some creative purpose. Visco-Gel is, as the name suggests, very viscous, and can stack up vertically without spilling over to adjacent tiles. Its primary use is creating liquid locks to prevent gas exchange between rooms, but if you've reached the late game, you've probably already made other liquid locks, so it's not the most exciting material. The only two advantages of using two Visco-Gel locks with vacuum in between is that they're a bit easier to set up and require less liquid than standard liquid locks with vacuum tile in here. They're also easier to accidentally mop up after your dupe makes a mess, as I demonstrate here. Quick side note, everything that I will say next about space travel to other asteroids only concerns the Spaced Out DLC, but there is no difference in terms of materials and recipes. In Spaced Out DLC, you have a hex-style star map, and you can land on asteroids and build additional bases there, and in the base game you can send rockets to space, but you can't interact with other planetoids and build anything on them. So to make Visco-Gel, you need 65 kg of petroleum and 35 kg of isosap, which you get like any other space material in the base game, but in Spaced Out, you can only get it by finding the marshy asteroid and giving dupe food, finally there's a use for my 7 million calories, to a sentient tree called Experiment 52B, and heating the sap that it produces to 125 degrees. There's plenty of guides on YouTube on how to do that efficiently, so I won't explain that in this video, but I basically set a conveyor to drop food to the tree and then pump all the sap into a tungsten volcano tamer, built the same way as all the other volcano tamers on my main base. The sap turns into isosap when it's heated by the tungsten, and the extra steam produced gets dumped by the steam turbine out into the space. The isosap then travels through metal tiles to chill and gets sent to my home planet through an interplanetary launcher, which is powered by the excess power produced by the volcano tamer. The isosap gathered this way can be used not only for creating Visco-Gel but also Insulite, which, if used for building insulated tiles and pipes, effectively stops any heat transfer indefinitely. The problem though is that it's pretty much overkill for everything, and I found both Visco-Gel and Insulite to be more trouble than they're worth. Just like Visco-Gel, Insulite is only needed in niche builds. For example, you could use insulated gas pipes made of Insulite to send steam through pipes without resorting to sending small packets with the help of gas meters. But the only two reasons for sending steam through pipes that I know of are powering sauna and using steam engines, and by the point you have Insulite, you don't need steam engines anyway. Similarly, insulated liquid pipes can be used to ensure your pipes don't break when you pipe liquid oxygen and hydrogen through them, and insulated tiles to ensure that the pools that you make and keep those in don't exchange heat with the surroundings. The only use for both of them is to power hydrogen rockets, and while liquid oxygen can be used in other rockets, liquid hydrogen can't, and if you make one, you can also make the other. You would go to such lengths only if you had to travel farther than the 20 tiles that a petroleum rocket can take you, return trip included, but even then you could easily go without a hydrogen rocket if you just build refueling stations along the way. That's what I would do in this situation where the gilded asteroid filled with fullerene that is needed to produce supercoolant is 11 tiles away from the home planet, though that would just make either the refueling station or the supercoolant redundant. And if it happens that temporal tear spawns at the farthest edge of the map for you, it's also not a problem to reach with a rad bolt or petroleum engine, as that's a one-way trip anyway. And if you're wondering if a planetoid that has the temporal tear opener can spawn farther than 10 tiles, no, it can't, I checked. That's the thing with all these endgame materials, they're all only useful for pushing the limits in this game. Supercoolant in particular is useful for its low freezing point and high thermal conductivity, something people use for making highly optimized boilers and other very sophisticated creative outlets. If you want to join the ranks, you'll combine gold, petroleum and fullerene in the emulsifier. To get fullerene, as I already mentioned, you'll have to travel to the gilded asteroid field, or we'll have to find graphite on one of the planetoids and combine it with aluminum and sulfur, and make fullerene from that. So how do you play the game? Do you reach for the stars and produce all the endgame materials, or do you get bored long before that? Let me know in the comments, and check out my other videos on oxygen not included, especially the one currently shown on the left-hand side. I'm pretty proud of it. See you there!